Andy Shum, about 12 years ago or thereabouts, I get a talk to a meeting of the Irish Meteorological Society, I remember it well, and I was asked to talk, and I think I was throwing around my head for a topic, and as Shum has alluded to, I was quite involved, as I still am internationally, and we had done some work with World Meteorological Organization on emergency management, emergency preparedness. So I chose this as my topic, and the question I was asking at the time was, you know, if we had an emergency in Ireland, what would we do? Because as far as I could see, there was virtually nothing happening in order to prepare us for that challenge. Now, I didn't know that at the time, but Shum was working on the development of a major emergency management framework strategy through that Northeast decade, if we could call it that. And that all came to fruition towards the latter part of that decade when 6 or 7 years' work along with the Health and Safety Executive and along with the local authorities, led by Shum through the Department and the Custom House, came together in the formation of, if you like, a focused approach to emergency management and the physical development of the National Emergency Coordination Centre in Agriculture House just across from us here on Kildare Street. So I suppose I got my first entree into that, we all did, on the 20th of November 2009, 3 days earlier there had been some very heavy rain in West Cork, which translated into serious flooding in Cork City on the 19th, evening of the 19th and the 20th, and we were summoned into this NECC, and that was my first taste of working in the context of emergency management. So we've come quite some distance from that, but I think we still have a long way to go. It's an evolving challenge, emergency management, and the weather contribution to it has to evolve also. So in the talk today, I'm going to try and give you a view, if you like, of that world of emergency management and show you where, at least from my perspective, our science of meteorology can best make its contribution. But first of all, to look a little bit at natural hazards and to ask what are they? And most of them are, in fact, meteorological in origin. So we've got windstorms, we've got floods, tropical storms, droughts, heat waves, that sort of thing. We've got the geological ones, such as the volcanoes, the earthquakes, and then we've got something like tsunamis, which have started off geologically, and then the disturbance, we would call it, that is carried in the ocean. Now, these graphs come from the Centre for Research into the Epidemiology of Disasters, which is a research centre based in the University of Louvain, which side of the Belgian language to where you come from, and looks at natural hazards. In this case, we're looking at 5 decades, starting in the mid-50s and ending in the mid-90s, and looking at the number of casualties per decade, so millions. And the blue are the hydrometeorological, and the green or purple and brown are the geological. So this is a very comforting graph for us in our meteorological work, because it shows us that through, hopefully, our work, we have managed to greatly reduce the number of casualties due to natural hazards through that second half of the 20th century, through all those developments in meteorology and in forecasting, which Peter Lynch and Julius Lincott talked about earlier on today. So that's been a good story. But the bad story is that when we look at this through the lens of economic losses, this is billions of US dollars per decade, we have almost the opposite graph. Because, of course, when we can move people out of harm's way, we can't move buildings out of harm's way, we can't move other assets, infrastructure, which has to sit there and be damaged or affected or destroyed by the event in question. So that's an interesting look. Now, if we divide up natural hazards and look at them in terms of where they come from, about 90% of them come from either hydrology or meteorology. So flooding is a big one there, windstorms, earthquakes, geological about 11%. The rest of them virtually have, if they're not directly meteorological, they are certainly very much affected by meteorology, such as epidemics, famine, and insects. So those are the numbers of disasters. This is the economic losses, looking through that lens again, and we see that flooding and windstorms are a major portion of that particular pie chart. So big damage, big infrastructural losses, big economic loss, if you like, attached to hydrometeorological events. And if you look at this regional distribution, and this uses the 6 regions of the world as the United Nations system, or more particularly the World Development Organization sees it, some interesting things emerge in Region 6, as it's called, in Europe, effectively. The biggest loss of life in the 25-year period from 1980 to 2005 images go with the CNN reporter wrapping around the pole in southern Florida with the hurricane sweeps in, you know, trying to have that dramatic shot by the roof of some tin shack and it bounces down the road behind them, the TV editors love that sort of stuff. But the 50,000 people who died in France were mainly elderly people, there were mainly poor people, there were mainly people who had some sort of predisposition because they had some lung difficulties or whatever. And in fact, the scale of this disaster wasn't really recognized until the bodies were piling up in the mortuaries. So nobody was saying the top person was killed by the weather. But in fact, they were, ultimately. And it's only through the examination of the statistics afterwards that these numbers, and they are obviously better mentioned on the estimates, came to be put together. Now, in Africa, it's epidemics and famine. In Asia, it's windstorms and earthquakes. The tsunami in the Indian Ocean is a major factor. The south, as we call it there, I suppose the southeastern quadrant of that map down over Australia. And in the US, flooding and windstorms. So the regional variation can change. This is only a 25-year period. And one event, a serious event, will very significantly, as in the case of France, skew these particular numbers. But they serve to show the range of potential meteorological and climatological disasters which can impact us in society. Now, emergency management, what do we think of when we hear the term emergency management? I suppose the first thing we think of is what we might call the blue light groupings, the ambulances, the fire brigades, the police, and indeed Sean's day job, so to speak, is as a chief fire officer for the country, so that's the background that he comes from. But if we look at it more broadly, we think of emergency management in terms of those daily services which underpin all of our lives. Electricity, as Derek has spoken adequately about, of course, heat, water, sewage, transport, schools, hospitals, the financial services, we can't get our money out of the hole in the wall or whatever. All of these are all part of the daily things that we do. And any disruption to any of them represents some sort of at least impact on society, and depending on the degree of that impact, then perhaps it becomes an emergency. Mark Thatcher famously once said there was no such thing as society. Beg to disagree, and I think society is schools, it's people playing football in the park, it's people going shopping, it's hospitals, it's people travelling to work. All of these daily activities all form part of the fabric of society. And the concept of societal resilience is about making sure that all of these normal day-to-day activities can continue more or less unhindered, or in some cases may have to stop for a particular reason, as they did in October, but for a short term in order to mitigate the longer term consequences. So emergency management is now very much about this resilience to society, all of these activities, and it's built around this particular concept. We have, if you like, that big explosion, the emergency event, whatever it might be, but it's part of a continuum. So we have planning and preparedness, we have the emergency event, we have the response, the recovery, then the analysis, and then the mitigation, feeding back into more preparedness for the next event. And traditionally, weather has really been focused, or in the public mind at least, on the event itself. It's been the traditional area of weather forecasting. Forecasts and warnings are forecasters in all med services, at least almost all med services throughout the world, maintain a 24/7 watch across the weather of Ireland, and its seas, and its airspace. They usually point up incoming severe weather within a few days' notice. Whether we issue our advisories or warnings closer to the time, those primarily go to the responders, the local authorities, the utility companies, the Gardaí, the HSE, and so on. And we have to ask the question, who needs to know, and when they get that information, what are they going to do with it? Derek has shown us an excellent example of how in ESP networks, as the warnings are taken in, there are, if you like, protocols, there are laid out descriptions of the expected impact on his business and therefore the actions that must follow that he and his colleagues must take, his managers and his operatives and so on in the business to deal with the impact. And this is coming back to my colleague Jerry Murphy's point about impact-based forecasts. We have to think a bit more about not just listening to the warning, but who gets it and what do we do with it. But to come back to our paradigm of emergency management, let's look at the planning and preparedness and what can we offer in our meteorological world to the planning and preparedness in the longer term for major weather events. So we talk about climate services, and that's something that we heard spoken of here earlier today. And that's, if you like, the longer term thinking. We have some estimate of the heaviest rainfall, and that we use that as a design criteria for drainage systems, for roads, wind loading for buildings, temperature humidity ranges for systems to keep temperatures, air conditioning, heating, and so on, into their proper airing zones, particularly for the elderly and for hospitals and the like. Also very important for industry, some of our pharmaceutical and high-tech industries, it's very important for them to actually know and to be able to keep a very controlled environment in their manufacturing areas, and to do that, temperature humidity is extremely important. Road transport, it's been talked about at the moment, but we have, of course, the system which Jerry described with the local authorities, where we provide forecasts to support the engineers. But in the longer term, we need to plan for how much salt do we need. The local authorities and indeed the private operators who manage much of the motorway network need to plan for how many crew they need to deploy, how many groups will they need. This is all the sort of longer term planning and thinking without which the capacity to deal with the event just isn't there. And road surfacing, which is an event which primarily takes place in the summertime because the nature of the surface that's being laid down needs certain temperature conditions and so on to be able to set properly. When they're driving home during the last summer evening, I found about four places that they were doing road surfacing between my work and my home, which caused me to maybe think unpleasant thoughts about road engineers, but this is part of what they have to do. Marine transport. The story I tell is a colleague of mine, a friend of mine who worked with a maritime company which operated ferry routes, and she managed a particular ferry route which was a little bit exposed to the Atlantic, and there were standard ferries on it, but there was also fast ferries on it that skim across the surface of the water. And the management across in the head office, which wasn't in Ireland, couldn't understand why this particular fast ferry had so many days when it couldn't travel. And it was because basically this route was exposed to Atlantic swell, and above certain height of swell, see, this thing just couldn't travel. And she bemoaned the fact that there wasn't one mariner on the board of that company who would understand this. So this is the sort of disconnect that can happen between, if you like, the planning on the ground and the planning that can take place among those who don't fully understand the implications of meteorological aspects, in this case oceanographic aspects. Air transport, of course, an industry driven by safety. Most ahead of time know the safe limits for takeoff and landing, must have some plan for cancellations and diversions, must build all that into its logistical thinking. Health, not something we think a lot of maybe in terms of weather, but in many countries, and we're a little bit behind the curve here, there's some work done in this country, but other countries it's more developed, linking weather events and climate events and longer-term weather events with increases or decreases in admissions to hospital or in doctor surgery appointments, and cardiac, pulmonary, even fractures in the case of snow and ice, risk of heat waves, the silent killers, as I mentioned. And then we have air pollution, which of course the EPA have recently brought very much into the fore as being one of those, I suppose, again, silent killers or silent impactors on our good health, which we need to consider a lot more carefully. In other parts of the world, vector-borne or weather-sensitive diseases are a very, very big challenge. So planning and preparedness, whether you're in a health service executive, whether you're a road engineer, whether you're running a maritime company, whether you're running an airline, you need to know something of the likely weather that you will face in the course of your operations in order to plan and prepare. And this is something we've been doing, I suppose, for many years. Coming to the impact, and I've deliberately drawn this circle a little bit more towards the purpose side now, because that indicates that our weather warnings, which are the first and most important task of any med service, and that comes back to the fundamental role of government to ensure safety and security of its citizens. That, if you like, vision that we've been able to give forecast warnings for has now extended, as been shown technically by my colleagues Sarah and Peter Lynch, from 2 or 3 days ahead now typically to 7 to 10 days ahead. And that improvement has happened very quickly, 4 or 5 decades. We can already see some scaling forecasts out to a month ahead. A seasonal forecast for this part of the world, there's no snow there yet. There is in other parts of the world because the climates operate differently, maybe tropical parts. But again,
these were announced, I think, in the context of more immediate preparedness and planning for events which you can see, which are beginning to come over the horizon, to prepare ever more early, if you like, for them. On some of the forecasts we've mentioned, and they can give a heads up for those very high impact, but low probability events for which most of us can probably ignore, but some may have to put certain courses of action to train to get ready for them, should they happen, even if it's under small risk, 5%, 10%. But again, in order to get full value, we need to match forecast to decisions and to actions. And we're at a very early stage of that in Ireland. I think we're only beginning, and I think Ophelia will give this process a significant kick, if you wish, to linking a forecast, be it a yellow status, orange status, red status, with a series of actions or protocols on behalf of those who must actually respond to impending weather events. So coming to the response phase. And the response phase is just after the event has happened. Now, Jerry talked to us a bit about impact-based forecasting, and the two concepts we have, if you like, to go with the hazard are vulnerability and exposure. That they're linked, if you like, there's some overlap there, but typically the vulnerability is the sort of thing that can happen when an emergency event has occurred. So, for example, it's been a lot of rain, the ground has been loosened, there's a risk of landslide. It's an increased risk because of the event is over, but there's an increased vulnerability there, perhaps to landslide. Tree root systems loosened. Rivers already full, so that a relatively small amount of rain falling on may actually cause that catastrophe. It might be literally the straw that breaks that camel's back. Back in 2010, we had the experience after the big freeze, which lasted, I think, up until just after Christmas, St. Patrick's Day, St. Stephen's Day saw a big thaw, and inevitably what happened, all those pipes which had burst during the freeze, and it was no one knew had burst, began to leak. So we had a lot of leakage problems to deal with over the following weeks and months, meaning a very large warm in this case. Again, this is a response phase challenge, which is a result of the event, but not something that happened with the event itself, happened somewhere afterwards. Buildings and walls destabilized. Very strong wind, roofs damaged perhaps, slates loosened, and maybe ready to come down because maybe a lesser storm coming along behind. So these are the vulnerabilities that can happen in the response phase, and we need to be very cognizant of them because if we're out there working in them, we need to, know about those. There's the domino effects, and again, we've seen this in our many years working at the National Emergency Coordination Group. Sometimes we've seen it in the mild form, and we've certainly been concerned sometimes of a more severe form happening, but to take an example, it went into nearly flooded, and if that then impacts on an ESP substation, that will cut out the power, which might cut out a water plant or a sewage plant, which might impact not just on houses, but on hospitals, businesses, and impact on health outcomes in case of hospitals or even shortage of goods. And there's an interesting situation at the moment in Puerto Rico, which I didn't know until after it had been devastated by the hurricane, that it's a major pharmaceutical producer in Puerto Rico. So whereas very slow response there in terms of getting the electricity network back up and running must inevitably have an impact on the pharmaceutical plants there, which I'm sure they have their backup generators and so on, but you would expect that may in time lead to some issues with the supply of certain pharmaceuticals and perhaps price rises. These are third and fourth order effects nonetheless. Then there's the exposure to responders who are out, as in the case of Derek's teams, trying to fix ESP lines, trying to clear blockages of water courses, maybe trying to stabilize equipment or places which have been damaged by the emergency event themselves. Public health nurses maybe trying to get out to see elderly folk and putting themselves in danger by being out to more serious weather falling on. We have that in the storm Brian came out of Ophelia, or even members of the public are the Good Samaritans in that case. So that increased emergency, that increased exposure is something we need to be very conscious of. We become very conscious of providing enhanced information to responders and to the public in those days after a big event because of that increased exposure, because that has perhaps been exacerbated by the falling weather system. Then the recovery phase, and that is after, if you like, the worst of the damage has been cleared up, but trees have been cleared, power outages was fixed, water is flowing again, floods have subsided, ISIS has all melted away, so that's fine, is it? But we may yet have many flooded properties which have to be cleaned and reinstated. That's not a quick job. People have had their houses for a year and more after flooding events. Damaged roads and buildings, that event in Donegal, which has been mentioned a couple of times, very localised, but huge damage to the road and bridge network in that part of the country. And again, the local authority have a big job there to do and reinstate all that. Not something that can be done very quickly. In the farming world, if there has been losses in animal farm, those have got to be made up, or farmers have decisions to make. Do they sell their animals now? Do they hope to buy in more fodder to replace what's been lost? And these, if you like, the economic decisions which you've got to impact on them. So these are issues that come along with the recovery phase. Where can we help? We can help in meteorology through planning and logistics, trying to define where effort should be focused, given, as always, limited resources. In transport, we may have assets out of the place, we have aircraft in the wrong place, logistic chains disrupted. Farming, those fodder stocks I mentioned. Insurance, making sure that those who have insurance policies, that their claims can be quickly validated by providing information to the insurance companies for their reports, that they are able to validate the claims and pay them quickly so that the insured person can get that money and get back on their feet quickly. And deciding when it's safe to resume what I call normal activity. Then we come to the analysis of the hazards. This is something which we've begun to do a lot more, certainly in a more systematic way in recent years after there has been a significant weather event. It's something indeed that we need to do to be in greater detail. So first thing to do is to look at the hazard in terms of what it's experienced, and our observation network, the resilience of it, is fundamental here. So what were the extremes, the rainfall, the gusts, the snowfall? How did they compare to the historical record? Do we need to rewrite that record? Julius Dingo showed us a very interesting slide earlier, in which they looked at it from the point of view of modelling the hazards, so seeing how the observed record fitted into the potential, and that's another very interesting approach. But this is how to understand better what our future weather will be in the light of our recent past. Verifying our warnings, did they work? Rewriting the forecast models. Did the forecast models give us the right guidance? If not, were there gaps? Was there certain information that was critically missing? You put that information in.
Yes, yeah.
Forecast, it teaches us how our forecast models respond to these emergency or extreme events. And it helps us to improve those models into dealing better with the next event. Modification of the risks. And a big area now, particularly in the context of looking at extreme weather through the lens of climate change, what are called attribution studies. To what extent can we say that any event was caused or was impacted or influenced by climate change? It's a question we get asked all the time. Every journalist who brings us after a big flood or a storm says, is this climate change? And we usually say, well, we can't say that because these things have happened before, there's natural variability in the weather. Probably the more honest answer is, we don't know. Because it's very difficult to disentangle the threads of variability of the weather, the natural variability, the underlying changes to climate change, and also what we call climate events, we have longer term events like winter droughts or perhaps the low pressure in the North Atlantic being displaced from its normal position for longer periods of time, that sort of thing, the El Niño event, event. So there's different threads that go into making up every different weather event as it's experienced. We're trying to disentangle them and say the attributions here, there, or wherever is a very, very difficult job. And one I think that scientists are only beginning to get to examine in the last number of years. In terms of then the emergency event, were there impacts that we haven't foreseen? Maybe we got the weather right, but we didn't foresee that a particular impact had happened. So we have to build that into our thinking. Human behavior, we see a warning, but then we take notice. Do people behave as we would have wished them to behave? A warning should be a call to action. A warning should be something which drives human behavior, both at the specialist level of somebody who has a particular job to do, and at the general public level of all of us in our own homes, with our own families, to be able to proper and appropriate decisions to keep ourselves and our families safe. So we have to think about that aspect. Was the communication successful? What lessons to learn. And then the mitigation phase, which is where we bring all that back into the planning and preparedness, build back better is the catchphrase here, and that applies not just to the physical infrastructure, but also to the concepts of resilience, and in some ways even the psychological infrastructure. or maybe don't get there at all, get it somewhere else, if that particular location has an identified vulnerability. New vulnerabilities might identify organizations, as you mentioned, and we have become globally now predominantly an urban living people, and we've become even more so. And the big megacities of the Far East and of Southern and Central America, you know, 20 million plus people, they have huge dependence on the underlying way of infrastructure, people living in these urban areas. And if that infrastructure is disrupted, of course, the vulnerability is greatly heightened. So that's a huge new vulnerability. And then the channels of misinformation. We talked about channels there of information being ballooned in the last 5 or 6 years with social media. But those channels can also carry misinformation. We're very fortunate in Ireland that we in Midland, through our strong relationship with RTE over nearly 6 decades now, have built up that position of authority and reach out to the people through radio and television. But those media are now becoming less important. And even though we still have that authority, you know, the day of Stromophilia, I would say the viewership numbers to RTE were way up because people tune into the national broadcaster, national public service broadcaster at times like that. But will that behavior will change? People will get information from other sources, not reliable sources, misinformation, put there either through ignorance or maybe through nonsense. So these are new challenges. So improving our resilience is physical, it's psychological, and it's societal. So again, to come back to this circle, this hopefully virtuous circle, this emergency management paradigm, how we deal with it, how we in our meteorological world contribute to it. But it's all about preparedness, physical preparedness, and a psychological preparedness. It's about knowledge and training, knowing the protocols through the response and recovery phases so that we can act and behave in safe manners during those particular parts of the cycle. Understanding afterwards the event in greater detail as we analyze it, and then applying that understanding to mitigation strategies. And ultimately building that better in terms of building our resilience as a society to the future.